What you should know about Detroit before entering the city. What you should know about Detroit in general. Obviously, Detroit's going through a really hard time. They've lost over 50% of their population in the last 40 or 50 so years. Their population continues to drop as both whites and blacks move out to the suburbs and other parts of the country, frankly. You have suburban areas growing in certain spots, and you have people leaving the city, massive unemployment, a lot of poverty, a lot of people stuck in certain places, a lot of people with very few economic options, financial options, not a lot of job opportunities. Education is a disaster in the city. A lot of illiteracy. But the city also has a lot to offer. Even though it is going through a hard time, the city just filed for bankruptcy. They had their emergency manager, Kevin Orr just filed for a bankruptcy, emergency, this is Chapter 9 bankruptcy. Simply because they have billions and billions of dollars of debt. They don't have a way of really paying back what they owe creditors. And frankly, their pensions are underfunded. Like a lot of governments, a lot of local governments throughout the country. So this is what makes this video, Detroit, relevant to you. Even if you don't plan on going through Detroit. I'm going to talk about a lot of things that are happening in Detroit that's going to affect you if you live in certain cities. And even if you live in certain states. Because a lot of these states are dependent on infinite growth. A lot of these states are dependent on more and more taxpayers paying money. But the problem is the biggest demographic block in this country, the baby boomers, is getting older. They move from their 50s to their 60s, and a lot of them are going to be retiring, which means a lot of them are not going to be in the workforce. A lot of that capital isn't going to be available. They're not going to be producing like they used to. And they're going to be drawing on Social Security and other programs. Programs that have been plundered by the government, to be frank. And I've never been a fan of Social Security as a mandatory program. But to be frank, a lot of the money is being mismanaged. And we're going to talk about that because it's not just a Detroit problem. It's an American problem, and it's going to affect you. So as we drive through Detroit, as I drive through Detroit and show you some of the downtown areas, we're going to talk about, I'm going to talk about my experience in Detroit. I'm not speaking as a resident. I'm speaking as somebody who has family there, who has friends there, specifically family. A lot of family in the suburbs and a lot of family in the city limits. Actually living in the city. I've driven through the city many, many times to go to different attractions, Detroit Institute of Arts, and we're going to talk about that more. Well, okay, first the bankruptcy situation. They recently had a lot of their resources at the Detroit Institute of Arts appraised. Obviously, they're going through bankruptcy, and they actually brought in somebody to actually appraise the value of a lot of that stuff that was there. Well, what does that really mean? It means that this stuff could be up for sale. Because Detroit, unlike a lot of museums, they actually own a lot of their art. Okay? They actually appraise about 3,500 of the museum's 66,000 objects. Possibly available for sale. This is one of the best things about Detroit. It's arts. It's culture district. But the arts could possibly be sold because of fiscal mismanagement. Why has Detroit fallen so much? What happened to the automotive jobs? That's a big reason why the city is in decline, but it's not just that. It's how the city responded, how its government responded to the decline in automotive jobs, to GM pulling back, taking jobs out of that city and bringing them to Mexico and other parts of the world. The deindustrialization of America. Well, essentially, they're instead of paying Americans better paying jobs, it's just cheaper to take the jobs overseas, where they don't have to worry about the unions, and they can take a step further and pay even less for the employment. They actually take resources from America and ship them to other countries, where they assemble things and put things together, and then they sell it. Then they ship it back to America and they sell it here, and it's cheaper. Detroit's decline is a symbol of America's decline. There was a time in the 1950s where, you know, a guy could actually work right out of high school. He can get a job. He can support his wife and his two or three or four kids with one job alone. That's what one job allowed him to do. Real jobs. Producing jobs actually involved making something. Well, I'm not saying women shouldn't be allowed to work outside of home. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that's a situation where women had the choice. Well, women didn't have the choice of working outside of home, but now we're in a situation where women, we went from women being forced to stay in that work in the home to women being forced to work outside the home. Simply because the dollar's devaluation and the amount of money paid out, the purchasing power of the average family has gone down dramatically. We went from a situation where the average family was saving money. They were able to produce, they were able to work, buy the things they needed, and actually buy some of the things they wanted, and then save money. Now, we're in a situation where people buy, can barely buy the things they need. And a lot of people are buying things they want, and ignoring the things they need. But they don't have enough to save. A lot of people don't save because they're not starting off with a lot of money to begin with. Well, again, because Detroit is facing bankruptcy, they were thinking about selling their arts. This is another sign of decline. And this is relevant to everybody else because there was a recent study on Detroit that concluded that one of the main reasons why the city was in such economic dire straits is because of corruption. Corruption. There was a report on Detroit's pension funds. They've been misspent. It was in the Detroit News. They've been misspent. Not a surprise. The practice actually began a lot of it in the mid-1980s. The city was, effectively robbed. Effectively robbing the city's pension funds to contribute to a significant underfunding. I mean, that's contributed to the significant underfunding of the city. They're robbing Peter to pay Paul. And that's what we're doing on a federal level, but people aren't really paying attention to that because we have something called a Federal Reserve, where they can print more currency and they can devalue the dollar. It's sort of like a hidden tax because it means that the dollars you already have become less and less valuable, but they can take those dollars and they can use them to fund programs. Wars. Unnecessary wars. Well, this will come to an end. This will get to the point where we will have to face the economic consequences. Detroit didn't have a Federal Reserve. So the thievery left to bankruptcy. So what do we have in the city? What you should know about the city? Obviously, a lot of good things going on in the city. But let's be frank. When I drive through the city, and I have second cousin. She's older than me, and she has a family, and, you know, I hang out with them. We go to Balao, which is a great place to go in Detroit, by the way. Balao is an island, obviously. There's a nature center. There's a big playground. There's beaches. I mean, it's a great place to go. You can go down to the riverfront. Great place to go. They actually have a statue dedicated to the Underground Railroad, the slaves who were involved in the Underground Railroad. People who helped free the slaves in the Underground Railroad. Wonderful. A lot of cool things down there. Civic Center, obviously, part of GM. But anyway, I she lives in a suburb of Detroit. And obviously, we always go into Detroit because we have family there. When I go down there, I go to her area, her city. Then we go into Detroit. Well, she says she doesn't go out at night in Detroit. And she's not the only one. She doesn't go out at night in Detroit because it's too dangerous. Too much crime. Too much craziness going on. It's one of the most dangerous cities in the entire country. Flint, the city I'm living in, one of the most dangerous cities in the entire country. I go out at night, obviously. But I don't go anywhere, whether I perceive it as being safe or unsafe, without a certain mindset. I'm always looking around. I'm always aware of my environments. I want to see what's going on around me, even if I think it has nothing to do with me. I'm always looking around. Situational awareness. And what that means is that if somebody's looking at you or somebody's moving towards you and something just isn't right, you have to know that before they even act. You have to be prepared to act. You can't just let yourself go off into la-la land. You can't just let yourself ignore what's going on around you. It's something that's very important. That's the first thing you have to keep in mind. It's the first thing I always keep in mind when I'm there. whether I'm there in the daytime or night. Because people get killed in the daytime and the night. Second thing, I don't go anywhere without my Glock 21. I have a concealed pistol license, and I use it. Plain and simple. Everywhere, if I mow the lawn, I have my Glock. Doesn't matter if I'm in Flint or Detroit or whatever. I have my Glock and two extra magazines. 13 rounds and for a 45 in each one. I would not consider going to the city or anywhere for that matter without some type of protection. Some type of tool you can use to protect yourself. Because the police calls, you know, you can call the police all you want. But the fact of the matter is, there's plenty of reports. Just go to Fox 2 in Detroit. There's plenty of reports of people calling 911 for robberies and nobody showing up. And now police not showing up for hours. 4 or 5 hours. Break-ins. A lot of times, and the same problem that happens in Flint. They're undermanned, for one part. They've been cutting in law enforcement. And frankly, you know, you call them, if you're not bleeding, there isn't an immediate threat. Don't expect them to be there anytime soon. Sometimes they're able to respond very quickly in Flint. Sometimes it takes a very long time in Flint. Sometimes they can respond quicker in Detroit, but a lot of times it takes a long time. And this is for serious calls. I'm talking strong arm robbery, even here in Flint. Taking hours for somebody just to call back, an officer to call back. In Detroit, you can't expect the police to show up in a matter of time. Look, everywhere you go, you got to be on alert. And this goes for whether you're in Detroit or not. Understand that if you drive around through Detroit, the city, the commercial, the downtown area is very different from the other parts of the city. In the commercial area, the downtown area, you have a lot of suburbians coming into the area. And they go for the Tigers games, and, you know, there's restaurants, there's Greek Town, there's a casinos, MGM Grand, which I haven't been to yet. We go to Greek Town Casino, you know, and I'm not a big gambler, but anyway, you know, some of my family likes to go there. That's where we go. And it's a wonderful place, but you got to keep in mind, what you see right here is only part of the story. This is only part of the city. And I gotta tell you, I really enjoy being in Detroit. Five Guys right there, just right there. I actually enjoy going there. I enjoy the restaurants when I can afford them. I enjoy getting on, you know, there's a people mover right there. That monorail system you see right there. Well, the train system, the elevated train, monorail. It's a people mover. It moves you throughout the downtown Detroit area. And there's all kinds of festivals. There's a Motown Museum, which I haven't got around to yet. There's a African American. There's a historical museum, which is wonderful. There's aquarium is on Belle Isle. That's okay. They're just getting it off the ground. They're just opening it up again. As you see, there's plenty of police officers in the downtown area, in a commercial area where the money's at, where the casino's at. That's not the issue. A lot of people worry about, oh, I'm not going to downtown Detroit. Let me tell you something about Flint and Detroit. They're two of the most dangerous cities in the entire country, but the downtown areas are very safe relative to the other parts of the country, other parts of the city. Much safer, much more security, much more police down there, more people. It's a much better environment. Like I said, they have different events, concerts, all kinds of stuff. In a bigger city, and it's a quality city if you know where to go and where to find good places. You can find good music. So it's not all gloom and doom. However, even though it does have all these positive attributes and the museums and stuff like that, you gotta understand that once you go into the residential areas, that's where you see the suffering. That's where you see a lot of the poverty. That's where you see a lot of people struggling. That's where you drive down these areas and you see like area of the house or every third house, you know, abandoned. You know, every fourth house, every third house. Even when you drive near these areas, you see a lot of these storefronts abandoned where there used to be businesses. You can tell there used to be a lot more people around. Now, you can go to the Eastern Market if you're looking for some fresh fruits. if you're looking for that type of thing, if you're looking for Mexican food, Mexican town, you know, a lot of those places shut down towards the nighttime, but, you know, you're going to see videos on that pretty soon. As soon as I get a chance, I'm going to go right down there. And obviously you can see buildings that give you little clues to what the city used to be like when it had more manufacturing. And the thing about the shutdown, the closures of the manufacturing plants and the factories is that there was a lot of factories and a lot of other businesses, secondary businesses, that relied on GM, that relied on Chrysler, that relied on them. And when the GM factory plants shut down, a lot of those other places that made parts for them had to shut down too. It had like a domino effect. You had all these different, you know, even diners and restaurants that used to make money off of, you know, workers coming in and buying food. Even they were affected by the decline. Even they were affected by that, especially. So when you drive through there, you got to understand there's a big contrast from the residential and the commercial areas. Now, when you go to the residential areas, I'm going to tell you straight up. Gas stations at night, not a place to be. Bottom line, gas stations at night, not a great place to be. You always got to be on alert. No matter how safe you think a place is, regardless of what city you're in. But gas stations, that's a big no-no at night. Every time you walk into a business, even if it's like a damn Pizza Hut, even if it's a Pizza Hut, I walked into a Pizza Hut and I saw armored glass, so-called bulletproof glass or whatever you want to call it. Nothing's really bulletproof in life, but hardly anything. But it's armored glass at a Pizza Hut. Even in Flint, we don't have a lot of that. We have it on the north side in certain places. But armored glass, it pretty much in any chicken place you go, any fish place you go, a lot of places like that, they're outside a commercial area. Because, you know, you can call the police in a residential area, and it takes a very long time for somebody to show up in certain situations, even if it is a serious call. Well, at night, another thing you have to be aware of is that a lot of the streetlights don't work. Some of these streetlights don't work, and that can be a problem, especially when you notice that a lot of the lights in general don't work. The street lights themselves don't work. A lot of the traffic lights are a problem. And it's a security problem. Because if you're driving to a residential area and it's super dark, I'm talking really dark. I mean, I'm talking you up in the country and you can see the stars type of dark. Okay? You look down the street and it's just darkness. You barely see cars coming. I mean, you see a little bit when a car lights up. But it's just complete darkness. It looks completely different than what you'll see from a city. You have these abandoned buildings, these abandoned houses, some of them burnt out, boarded up, and you look down the street, you can't see much of anything. It's just darkness. Even if you're visiting a friend, we went to visit one of my cousin's friend, right next door, darkness, right across the street, abandoned house. Two or three abandoned houses just right next to hers. It's like two abandoned houses right across the street from hers. Abandoned house right to the left of hers, or was it to the right? And the whole block is dark. You see that in all kinds of places throughout the city. Darkness. And then you have these, just like in Flint, the grass, just when the properties are abandoned, the grass grows and grows and grows and grows. And it starts to look like, you know, a damn woodland type of environment. I'm talking it goes up to your knees and beyond. Grass is pouring out. Weeds is pouring out. So you have these overgrown weeds, these overgrown grass, areas where people can hide, and you pull up to a stop sign or a light, and you don't know who's lurking in the bushes. You don't know who's lurking in the grass. You don't know who's lurking behind the trees. And it's complete darkness. It's not a safe. You got to be on alert. This is why I lock my doors every time I get into the vehicle, even if there's somebody in the vehicle with me. Friends make fun of me. Hey, you locked the door? Yeah, of course I locked the door. Because I don't know if somebody's going to sneak up in the parking lot and open up a door and pull a gun on us. You have absolutely, all it takes is a split second. And I can't depend on other people being aware. And I do that no matter what neighborhood I'm in. My friends laugh at me, but you know what? and somebody's going to get in that van, they're going to break a window or something. It only takes a few seconds for somebody to slide behind a bush or something and go up to your car door. This is why I tell people, please consider getting a concealed carry license, a concealed pistol license. Almost every state offers one. Pretty much all states offer one. Some make it a lot harder than others, but most states is fairly reasonable. It's fairly simple to get one. You take an NRA class for a lot of these states. You fill out paperwork. They submit it to the FBI or feds, and they once you're cleared, weeks later you get your license to conceal carry. It's something people should take seriously. I know some people think, oh, well, my area is safe. It may be safe now, but if things turn south, if things get worse nationwide, if things get worse in your area, you lose your job, and all of a sudden you can't afford the $100, $150 NRA class. You can't afford a $110, $115 fee to get that license. You're going to be glad that you acquired that license when it was easier and when you had the money to do so. Detroit, yeah, a breakdown of infrastructure with the streetlights. You have animals, pets being abandoned. There's an article, Rolling Stone's article entitled City of Strays, Detroit's Epidemic of 50,000 Abandoned Dogs. And I, you know, there's depopulated residential areas. Areas where there used to be like blocks where there used to be maybe 20 houses or 10 or 15 or 20 houses or so in certain couple blocks or so, and now you only have like three or four. You have blocks where, you know, there's only like a couple people, a couple populated houses around. You have dogs just roaming the city, big dogs, small dogs, people abandoning their pets, people abandoning the city. I'm talking pit bulls, different breeds. And it's not that one breed is worse than another. It's just that, you know, people oftentimes misuse the dogs. They are cruel to the dogs. They cheat the dogs if you mean. Then they, obviously, if you're being that irresponsible, you might be the type of person that will abandon the dog. And then the dog ends up on the street. You have a mistreated animal on the street that's hungry. Well, you add that in with the fact that the infrastructure is falling apart. The streets look terrible, especially once you go inside the residential areas. The commercial areas, there's better police coverage, there's better services in general, but where the people actually live, that's where things get worse. The suburbians come in to the city and they buy their stuff, they work, they do all this stuff, see ball games, whatever. Restaurants, a lot of good stuff there. Matter of fact, they had a New York City ballet go actually perform at the Detroit Opera House. I love that. Love ballet, but I'm getting off track. You have darkness in areas, overgrown grass. You have dogs running wild. You have a situation where if you call 911, who the hell is going to show up? You got to wait hours for the police to show up. Even if you say somebody broke into your house. Crime, robbery is so extreme. Crime and robbery is so bad that you can't even walk into a Pizza Hut without seeing armored glass windows. Is that bad? Yet, there's still good things in the city. But, you know, what does this say about the future of America? Because Detroit used to be the heart of the middle class in this country. Cities like Detroit, Pittsburgh with their steel. Pittsburgh was more diverse and they were able to adapt to the changes economically. The deindustrialization of America. But Detroit was so dependent and focused on automotive that it was devastated when the transition happened. Completely devastated. So Detroit, city of strays, city of darkness. There's a great sense of hopelessness in the city. People with jobs that they absolutely hate and they know they aren't going to lead anywhere. You see it in the Walmarts. You see it in, even outside of Detroit, you see it in the pizza places, the restaurants, certain restaurants. It's, you know, you see it. See it in their eyes. They don't care about the job they do. They're not being paid practically anything. So they don't care. And that's not everybody. It's not everybody at Walmart. But you know what I'm saying. You have a sense of hopelessness in the city of Detroit for a lot of people, from a lot of people, and even outside of the city. And it's interesting contrast because you have these suburbians, and I'm not even saying they're all doing very well, but you have a lot of these middle-class suburbians who still have professional jobs, semi-professional jobs in the city, in the commercial area. They come into the area to work and play, and the resources that the city does have is being focused on protecting them and providing the resources they need. Then they leave the city. There's a great exodus towards around 6 and 7 is still pretty tough, but great exodus. It gets dark, and there's no resources, there's no police protection, ambulances for the people. I read a story about the ambulance in Detroit. Underfunded. Some of those ambulance vehicles were broken down. Where's the fund to fix this stuff? Reports about how long it took for the ambulance to respond. People dying waiting on ambulances. People dying waiting on help in the city of Detroit. Ambulances, vehicles without GPSs, $200, $250 devices. And they're taking forever because they can't find the places because they don't have the GPS. And then you had the fire departments. Lacking resources. So this is why I talk about Detroit, because I think it's an indicator of things to come nationwide, whether you like that or not. You can look at the city and say, oh, well, that's just them. The Democratic Party went wild in that city, and that's true. The automotive industry was the biggest problem, going downhill and moving the jobs out. But then the Democratic Party, the way they responded to it was disastrous. Their policies were disastrous. There's no getting over it. And unfortunately, it was too easy to put a black face in front of people, in front of the 85% black population, and get them to vote for people who didn't care about them at all. And you see the same thing with guys like Obama. Too many black people willing to support these characters who are only there for an agenda that doesn't even serve their own. America Patrick, completely corrupt. Part of the city's culture of corruption. This is not just a Detroit problem. This is an American problem. But soon, people will know. Soon, people will understand that. So I just want to give you guys a look at the city of Detroit. The inside, the great contrast. In a weird way, you have two Detroits. You have the commercial areas, the downtown area where the suburbanites come into, and then you also have the residential area where the people live. You know, so you have the corporations in the downtown area that get all the resources, that get all the support from even from the city government, and then you have the people in the residential areas, and it's sort of like, the hell with you. Somebody in your house? Somebody broke in your house? The hell with you? Doesn't that remind you of what's going on nationally? Doesn't that remind you of something that's going on in Washington? Even when you look at Washington, D.C., even when you look at Chicago, you have these financial districts, these well-off areas, and then you have these other areas that are like complete slums, where a third or half the population of kids graduating or going to the school systems can't even read. Two Chicagos, two Detroits. Great contrast in Washington, D.C. You have the crooked-ass politicians and all that government money in the suburbs of D.C. And then you have just devastated areas inside D.C. Well, you see that right there in Detroit. But see, here's the thing. Everybody's thinking, oh, they're going to be in the commercial area. They're going to be in the downtown Detroit. No, the people are in the residential areas. And even the black folks who moved out into the suburbs, the poverty followed them. A lot of them aren't doing very well, even in the suburban areas. A lot of them are still on government assistance, even in the suburban areas. It's not all, oh, when you move to the suburbs, you must be middle class. Middle class in America is evaporated. Middle class used to be if some guy can go to work and with one job, support his wife and his kids. Now it's, you know, the wife has to work in the home and outside the home. and is and they're lucky if they have the father there. And if he's there, they're lucky if he can get the same, get a job that's good enough to really help out. And then they gotta send their kids, what, to college? So their kids get into debt and repeat the whole damn cycle all over again? Meanwhile, they're not saving up for their own retirement. That's what we have here in America. So the transformation we're seeing in Detroit is a reflection of the transformation we're seeing right here in America. And it's happened all around us. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for today.